continuation passing style. So we'll start with continuations, the idea of continuations, and then talk about this thing called continuation passing style. And if time permits, we will also look at implementing interpreters using continuation passing style, and also try how we can implement called CC in your own, like continuation in a language. So yeah, so this is the idea, the brief outline of the talk, idea of continuations, and we'll spend a lot of time there. And so we'll use scheme. So the scheme has this thing called call with current continuations. So we'll spend some time with that. And we'll also talk about tail call optimizations. Already we there was another talk about tail calls and how to do tail calls. We'll see yet another way of achieving tail call optimization. Then if time permits, we'll write a toy scheme interpreter and implement the same using CPS, and also implement call CC. Anyway, I'll put the code out there if time is insufficient. Yeah, little bit about me. I am basically an electrical engineer, mostly self-taught programmer. I work for this company called Concur Technologies, where we are trying to scale the backend using some functional programming techniques, and have contributed to a few free software projects. Yeah. So very brief introduction about scheme. We'll be using scheme here. I think we have already looked at closure code and also other Lisp code in the other talks. Bruce Tate's talk also had I think the Morten's talk had some scheme code there. So scheme is called by value. It is eagerly evaluated, and it has its expressions. The first thing in a S expression is assumed to be a function, and the rest of them are operators. And you can override that with the code and change code to data and back to code. And there are very few built-in constructs. And other thing that we take for granted, which is lexical scoping, first appeared in scheme. I think it first appeared in Algol, but yeah. It's one of the first Lisp that got lexical scoping right. And then functions as first class, and usually these things are covered in most of the introductory programming courses that use Lisp. But macros and call CC, those are considered to be some of the difficult parts to understand in scheme. So yeah, so the, one of the thing is what I'm trying to cover in this lecture. The other thing is that my goal for this talk is that you go back with some understanding of continuation. I had a lot of difficulty understanding continuation. So my goal is that you go back with some intuition about continuation, so that you can look up by yourself and understand more. And at any point of time, please interrupt and ask questions during this talk or later or any point of time. Yeah. So yeah, this is the famous quote that is used at the starting of the R5RS standard, the scheme revised report on scheme. Programming languages should be designed not by piling features on top of features, but by removing weaknesses and restrictions that make additional features appear necessary. So continuation is one such feature. It's like a, one of the primitive things on top of which you can implement a lot of other control constructs. We'll see at least one or two of them. Okay, so let's say we want to add two numbers. Very simple, we just want to add two numbers. Let's say that you are reading the first number from somewhere, and then you are reading the next number, you are adding it and displaying it. So read number could be so this could be say in a web scenario where you are asked to input, say a toy example, say you are asked to input first number on a web page, you have to press a submit, then you are asked to enter the second number, again press submit and gives you a number 2 or whatever number, 42 or whatever. So so when you press, when you enter the first number and when you are asked the second number, the web server has to remember that you have already entered the first number. So there is a computation suspended out there which already has, which knows what it needs to do once you have entered the first number, right? So this, you can encapsulate it in a function, that what it needs to do once I have read the first number. It's nothing but a function. It takes the first number as a parameter, then it reads the second number and does the addition and gives you the result. So continuations are nothing but the rest of the computation that you need to do. But rest after what? So after some context, that is, you have done some work. Now, so once you have that value, what you need to do to complete the rest of the program, that is what is continuation. So let's take the first expression there. That is, you're multiplying 3 and 4, adding it with 5, and giving back the result. Now, let's look at 3. When you are looking at 3, what is it that you need to do to complete this computation? This is nothing but, so at the point of 3, we have put a question mark there. So given 3, I need to multiply it with 4, add it with 5, give me back the result. So you can, that is what is shown in the next two expressions. So if V is 3, then we compute it using a let expression there. So let is nothing but syntactic sugar over lambda, right? That is, you have a let, you can transform it into a lambda expression. It's a function application. Once you are given 3, you just apply it and get the result. Now, if you really see that the function, the first function, the function, the lambda expression, so that is really the continuation. That is what you need to do once you get the value 3. Is this clear? This much of it is clear? Anything unclear about it? Yeah, so forget about compiler right now. Think about a program execution in an abstract way. That is, you are sequentially executing some program. At some point, what is the rest of the program? Can you encapsulate it in a function? That is what continuation is. Continuation is nothing but a closure that takes one value as a parameter. That value is nothing but the computation we have done as of now. Once I am given that value, what do I need to do rest? That is encapsulated by this function. And that is what continuation is about. Any other questions? Is it clear? Whatever is explained as of now. So now, if you see, any program implicitly has a continuation. Only thing is that most of the languages are not explicit about it. Languages does not allow you to capture continuation into a variable. Continuations are not first class in most of the languages. Any C program or whatever program, an assembly program, you have continuation. That is, you always have a rest of the computation, right? So let's take another example. The same expression. Now, let's say we are evaluating that expression. Before evaluating, what is the continuation of that program? Let's say you are inputting that expression into a REPL. What is the continuation of the program? You have to just return the result, right? That's the continuation. You just have to return the value. So the continuation of that is an identity function. Now let's say you are looking at the inside expression star 3 and 4, multiply 3 and 4. What is the continuation of at that point? It is once I get 3 and 4 multiplied, I need to add that value with 5 and return the result. So that is the continuation of that program at that point. So you can also say that lambda v plus v and 5 is the context of star 3 and 4. That is, what do I need to do to get the entire result, given that I am looking at 3 multiplied with 4. Now let's go still further recursively. Now you are looking at 3, looking at the star 3 and 4. That is, you are looking at it at the evaluation order from left to right, let's say. So when you are looking at 3, same thing repeats. So I hope you get the idea. So these continuations are only up to the printing of the result at the REPL. If you really see, continuations go all the way up to the scheduler, right? The scheduler is what is actually calling this program and actually running it. So rest of computation is going all the way up to a process schedule. Yeah. Yeah, that's. Only if the order of evaluation, so if you are converting a program into a continuation passing style or into like explicit continuation, then your order of evaluation is explicit then. Any questions at this point? Yeah, yeah. So, yeah. No. So there, it never returns. If you really see, you are actually calling the continuation of the program. So here, if you see, the big expression, the first, right? Continuation of that is nothing but a identity function, right? So, given the value of that, you. So we are going only up to the REPL here. Actually, there are a lot of other things happening after that, but we are not capturing it here. So there are other things like delimited continuations where you can actually put a, like you can focus on one portion of the program and say that this is what I really care about, the continuation up to this point. You could do that, but this is not delimited continuation. I am not covering delimited continuation in this talk. Here I am assuming left to right. So if you actually convert a program into a continuation passing style, you have to assume some or you have to make it explicit, right? Without that you cannot. Yeah. So that's one thing I am assuming here. Now, if you really see, this is an alternate model of evaluation, or it's an alternate model of thinking about how to do computing, right? In a normal von Neumann architecture, in a normal C or any von Neumann program execution model, you have a stack, and let's say function A called function B. Function A will have its return address pushed into the stack, then it calls B. Then it returns back to the stack and pops out the return address and jumps into that value, right? So we are essentially modeling the same thing with continuation. So stack and continuations can really be thought of alternate ways to think about the same thing. Yeah, so some more examples to just drive the point. What is the context of char 3 and 4 in this expression? So, as a first step, what we do is we replace the expression of interest with a question mark. So, our expression of interest is char 3 and 4. So, we get that second expression. Now, try to simplify that expression. Do exactly what we discussed last time. That is, you wrap the whole thing in a lambda, that is your continuation. Now, 0, 5 is not 0, right? You simplify that. So, the if condition will fail. So, it will take the second branch and wrap it in a lambda. So, that is a continuation of this expression. It's clear? Yeah, one more example. So, again, what is the context of char 3 and 4? The first step again, I simplified the first the value as well here in the first step. So here multiple things are happening, so we need to wrap it in a begin. N is 1, we know that N is 1. So it goes to the second branch and it has to return the value of N. So actually I had to return the value 1 there, it's a typo there. So begin, so that's what happens there. Now, you wrap the whole thing in a lambda, right? So, that is a continuation as far as char 3 and 4 is concerned, yes. No, continuation will be different in that case. So, if n is 0, what is the rest of the program? It will take the first branch, right? First display it will take. Right, so the continuation is different in that case. Continuation means rest of the program. So rest of the program is going to be different in that case. Clear now? Yes. I agree. Context of 3 and 4 is irrelevant. You don't have to evaluate. You can actually find continuations for all possible branches. Are just for thinking about continuation. This is not how a compiler will do. What a compiler will do is it will do source to source transformation before it actually. So during compilation time, CPS is one pass. That is, it will pass the continuation at every point. We'll see some examples. I'm coming to some examples there. So, what is the point here? So, point is that we make control flow explicit, right? Other control operations like loops, non-local exits, coroutines or generators, you have the yield in Python and things like that, right? See, you can represent all of that in using this primitive. You can think of continuation as a primitive to implement rest of the control flow operation. So that is again, if you see scheme, that's a theme in the entire language, where you have things that can be build from bottom up. It's, you have small or very orthogonal primitives at the bottom, and you build the rest of the things using these. So we'll see an example of a non-local exit. We'll not have time to go through generators and coroutines, but we'll see non-local exit. So third point there is that continuation is present in every program, if you see. Nothing but rest of the computation, right? But not all programming languages allow you to capture it in a variable, go back to that continuation and things like that. Very few languages support it. ML supports it, standard ML that we saw Bhaskar's talk. Scheme supports it. Yeah, so there are a few such languages. So that brings us to the construct used in Scheme called call CC or call with current continuation. So call CC has a very weird API, but essentially let's look at this example again, because we had been thinking about this for a while. So again, come back to the same expression star 3 and 4, that is the context we are looking at. Now let's say you want to capture the context of star 3 and 4 in a variable. This is what you need to do. So you wrap star 3 and 4 in this expression called call CC. So call CC, call with current continuation. Current continuation at that point of time is passed in a variable called k. Now that k itself is wrapped in a lambda. So call CC's argument is a function which takes another function k. So it's very confusing. You can there is another construct called let CC that takes just k. But essentially k is nothing but the current continuation that we had been talking about. That k is nothing but the lambda expression that we have written there. Lambda of v, star of v, plus, that is given the value of 3 and 4 multiplied, what do we need to do next? That is bound implicitly to the value, to the binding k. So now we just return it. We are actually not using k. So k has a scope inside the lambda, right? It has got the scope only within the lambda expression. We are not using k there. So you can actually use k. K is nothing but a function, right? K is nothing but a closure which takes one value as a parameter. So you can actually apply k to star 3 and 4. So what do we get? It will just behave like the original expression, plus of star 3 and 4 add with 5. It will just behave like that. So what does it do? It will just return 3 and 4 multiplied. Now let's do something interesting. To define a global variable star k star, that's a convention in the Lisp world where globals have this earmuffs, you put stars on both the sides. Now what can you do within the lambda? You can capture k, which is current continuation, and set the star k star with that value, and it returns back. Now you can actually call, let me try to why doesn't it show here? It shows on the screen. You need to mirror it. It does not show anything here. Yeah, it's there, but it's not showing the screen. Display. It's not. It's actually not detecting that device. Otherwise, it is okay. Yeah, it's not. Oh, yeah, that is a possibility. I'll try to move it into this. That won't. Okay, yeah. 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 No, it didn't show. It's okay, I think. It's okay. I think I'll just talk. It's, yeah, I get this, but I don't get any other application. So let's say, I want to show the racket. Just on the star k star, we have actually captured the continuation. And the continuation is nothing but this function there, the lambda function. Lambda of v plus v and 5, that's the continuation. Now you can actually apply star k to any other value. So you can pass pass say 42 into that. If you pass 42, you'll get 42 plus 5 instead of char 3 and 4. So it's like you have captured the rest of the computation at that point of time, and you can go back to that point of time later. Yeah. Yeah. So first one, right? Yes. That will also be 17. No, K we are not using. K is not identity. K is the continuation at that point of time, current continuation. So we are not using K there. It's just returning that value. This expression, this one you are saying, it will compute, it will complete its computation. I am not able to show the racket ripple here. Control goes to the lambda, control goes to the expression inside the lambda. Yes, it just returns the last value of it, just returns. You have a choice to use K and do something interesting with it. Yeah, you are exactly, you are placing a marker there. So you actually captured the marker in a variable K. That is all it is. Using that, exactly. Because we are storing it, we are able to come back there. It's just a marker. Exactly. Yes. Correct. So here there is no difference between this, the value returned here, and the value returned here. Why? Because K is the same. If I had used a different, so K is what? K is current continuation. Current continuation for this expression is what? Is a lambda function, right? It has to take the value and add 5, return the result. Here also it is the same thing. So what are we doing here? We are essentially calling this lambda function, lambda of v plus v and 5, with the value star of 3 and 4. Understood? Yeah, yeah. Interesting things will happen. The thing is here, the continuation k is nothing but this function at the bottom. We are now calling that function with star of 3 and 4, which will return the same value 17. Understood? Now if you use another value there, let's say you use another value. Yes. Correct. We are actually jumping to the, we are actually calling the continuation with the value star 3 and 5. Yes, it will not do, it will not do. It's actually jumping into the continuation that we have captured in K. It will not come here. Yeah, that's an important point. Yes. So you actually, you never returned from this value. You have actually, you have passed the control to another point of time. I'll show another very interesting example. I'm expecting to spend at least 5 minutes on that. We'll come to that. So yeah, so this is actually same thing. We captured the value K into star K star, we apply to some other value, like 20, you apply, you get a different value, because the rest of the computation you are applying to a different value. Yeah, so one simple application of this, let's say you want to, I should have called the break as return here, you want to, scheme does not have a return expression, like in C, right, you have returned some value. Now let's say you want to implement return in scheme, I think instead of break, let assume return. But let's say that you are multiplying a bunch of numbers recursively, and let's say you have if you encounter a zero at some point of time, you don't want to just multiply blindly. You want to return immediately without doing any further computation. That's what you want to do. So if you just do recursively, you still get the same result, but you will end up, even if say first value is zero, you have say 1 million numbers, you will still end up multiplying the whole thing, right? Now let's say you want to return the moment you enter, you encounter a value zero. So what do? You capture the continuation, outermost continuation. You are using call CC right at the outside, right? The first thing you do inside the function is capture the current continuation in a variable break. You look at char of ls, the list. If it is zero, you call break. So it just returns the value zero, because the current continuation that you have captured is nothing but it's just exiting out of the program. Else you do the usual stuff. Is this clear? This example, it's a non-local exit. Yeah, it is nothing but a closure. It takes one value as input. It's nothing but this. Because break, what is break? Break is nothing but a function that represents the continuation at that point of time. So what does it do? It just did a go to there. Yeah, it returned actually. So what does it return? Let's come to that. What is break? What is a break value? What will it be? It will be an identity function, right? It's an identity function. It's not some lambda, it's identity function. Because we are capturing the break right at the outermost part, correct? That's what we are returning. Break 0 returns 0. We don't want to do that. That's why we did that, right? The moment we encounter a 0, we want the control to jump to the place where we are exiting the program. No, we are actually calling the break. We are calling the continuation with the value 0. The continuation is nothing but a closure. It's a lambda. Yeah, takes one parameter. Now, what is that closure in this case? It's an identity function, right? Yes, it is true. Yeah, it's a closure.
So let's look at what that lambda
is. No, if you, yeah, right. Yes. Yeah. Break 0, return 0. What is it used for? That is nothing but the continuation at that point of time, right? Yeah, it will not use the else part. Moment it encounters a 0, it will just return, it will jump out to the value. It will jump out to the end of the function. Because break is what? Break is the current continuation when we started, it is the outermost part, right? If you had put break somewhere else, or if you had used call. No. Let's say we are, the first example here. First example, that is, it does not have a 0.
Let's say if I call continuation, lambda x plus 1. So, this is what will be 1.
Lambda of x.
So, the continuation is x plus 1 plus x 1.
Okay.
So, I want to increment the value.
Yeah. So, if you pass the continuation along, so you are calling the product with a plus 1 of product something, right? It will return 121. Because the continuation at the break captures the continuation, right? What is the continuation? Given the product, I need to add 1. You are not calling, but it actually returns that value, right? So it's the same example as this that you are talking about, right? Say this, like you have some value, instead of star of 3 and 4, we are doing that product there. But let's say you wrap that call CC inside the product and you are adding some value 1, right? So if you just return, it will just return that value. If you don't use break there, it will just, that is the continuation at that point, right? So break has actually, or k has captured this continuation lambda of v. What do I need to do to complete this expression? That is, what is the context around this expression? Context is nothing but you need to add some value to the result and return that value. Okay, so non-local exit. Now this is a bit complicated example. If you let's spend some time on it, and if we really understand this, I think you can really claim that you really understand continuation. Now, so you have a let expression. There is a binding x. All it does is call CC lambda of k, which is a current continuation k. It returns that value k. That is what the x is getting. Now, in the body of let, all you are doing is you are calling x, you are invoking a function x with another function lambda ignore high. That is a function. Now, this returns high. Think about it for a minute. Don't see the rest of the part. Try to think only at the first part of the expression. Please do not see the rest and try to see if you really see it. So we have captured the value k, which is nothing but the current continuation, and that value goes into x and it prints the value high. So to break it down again, go back to the same thing that we talked about, the steps that we took. What is continuation k? K is the current continuation at that point, right? Wrap the whole context of that in a lambda, right? That is the first step you can do. So you wrap the whole let expression, remove that call CC, because that's the context, right? K is returned, context is returned to x. So the continuation is nothing but a lambda of v, assign the value v to x, invoke x. Now what do we do? Now we invoke that continuation, this continuation, lambda of v, the whole thing. Now we invoke this with another function, lambda ignore high. At that point, what happens? X gets bound to v, which is this argument lambda ignore high, once again, right? X gets bound to lambda ignore high, and then we invoke lambda ignore high, and it returns high. Understood this? Somebody said no. What exactly you didn't understand? Okay, I'll explain once again. What is the continuation k? So call CC or call with current continuation means you are passing the current continuation. What is the rest of the computation at that point into the variable k or into the identifier k? So k is bound to the current continuation. Now you are actually just returning k there inside the call CC. So that value, the current continuation of the current program that I am running, gets bound to the identifier x. Now I am invoking x with the function lambda ignore high. Now at that point, what happens? This continuation, the second expression there, gets invoked with the argument lambda ignore high. Now what do we do there inside? We are bounding the argument that we are passing to x. So x gets assigned another value again, and then we invoke lambda ignore high with another lambda ignore high, and it just returns high. Understood? Okay. Ignore is a parameter, right? This is what. So x got bound to lambda ignore high, right? Yeah. So now you are just invoking that here, function invoking. ignore is going to be ignored, right? Yeah, yeah, exactly. No. So it will be lambda ignore high. Lambda ignore high. And we are ignoring that function, returning high. Yes. Exactly. Yes. Yeah, you don't need any other special constructs. Right. Yes, yes, yes. This? Okay. Yeah, exactly. It is AA. Nothing but AA. Here, so ignore gets assigned to this value. It's an anonymous function, right? Lambda ignore high. Now, you understood up to this? That's understood, right? Okay. This is the simplest thing. You just apply this function to another function. Now, this whole thing gets assigned to ignore, but we are not using ignore here. We are just returning high. Yes. Then it would have invoked this function. Yeah, but you can do some variants of this. Like, let's say if you put instead of lambda ignore high, if you put something else. Yeah, but I hope how you reach there to the last statement, I think that is the most important thing. How you actually invoke last statement, probably not the important thing, but how you actually reach there, what is the continuation, what is the value of k? So you can easily break it down using this technique, that is you replace the area of interest with a identifier, wrap the whole thing in a lambda, that is your continuation. So now let's say the hello world of functional programming, factorial example. So that's how you write a normal factorial example, right? So we have 15 more minutes. That's how you write a normal factorial example. That is, if n is 0, you return 1, else you do. The example that the tail call optimization talked about. So you invoke factorial of 5, then you have a triangular like execution model. That is, you have to store the previous value and it's a normal execution. Now. The case of tail call optimization, or if all your calls are tail calls, then you get a very different execution state. That is, you can call this as accumulator passing style. Wherein you also have some identity value in an accumulator, and you keep adding your accumulating the result. You're essentially, folding your value in intermediate values and computing the result. So this has a very flat stack, or the fact ACC is can be it can be just a jump, because you don't have to store anything to be done after we call the fact ACC, right? So I think you will start seeing some very painful. So what do you do? Fact slash k has a continuation k as another parameter. So one more parameter it takes. And k, when you invoke a fact, is nothing but identity function. You just have to return the value. Now what do you do? Now k is continuation. This k and that k you are confusing. I think I should not have used k in the invocation. I should have used, it should be it's just an ID, it's an identity function. Yeah, I should not have, k at that point is the current continuation. Yeah, you can, k always takes one parameter as input. No, that you invoke k with one parameter. You can return k. K is first class, right? It's a closure. You can return, pass it around, do whatever you want. Yeah. When you invoke, you need to invoke with one parameter. Takes one parameter. K is. Yeah, yeah, sure, sure. Yeah, I think it should not be k, I think you should call it n or whatever. That's the continuation of this program. No, they are not continuation. Yeah, yeah, that's identity, exactly. Exactly, yeah. Yeah, yeah, that has nothing to do with continuation, it's a wrong usage. Yeah. So, what is happening here? So, we converted our previous simple factorial function here, right, into a continuation passing style. So, what do we do is, first thing is we add a new parameter k which represents continuation. Now, if n is 0, we have to invoke the continuation and return the value 1. Now, take the second example, the second branch of it. So, if n is not 1 or if n is not 0, what do you need to do? Given the value of factorial of n minus 1, we need to multiply that result with n and return the value, right? That is what we have in this, right? Given factorial of n minus 1, multiply it with n, return the value. That is exactly what is done here. So, you create a new continuation inside the second invocation, the invocation of fact slash k. So, you are actually creating a new continuation, and that continuation has to, what should it do? It has to, given the value of fact n minus 1, multiply with n and return the value. So, that is what is happening here, right? If no, you should say k, you should say k 1. That is where it unfolds exactly. Actually, this program does not return. It actually passes the control to k. This program does not return. It has no return value. All continuation passing style programs never return. Exactly, yes. This is clear? Okay, some more examples. We have 10 minutes. I think I cannot show the interpreter program with this laptop, I think. I can try with another laptop. Yeah. Continuation? No. We actually used it in an assignment, both of us, Anand and me, together, while we wrote a Python interpreter in scheme. Yeah, in bracket. We actually used it to implement generators, for example, yield operator in Python. Yeah. So the compiler is, if you have used any functional language, this is one of the first steps that happens in any functional programming language compiler, Haskell or scheme or anything. You can actually implement it in scheme with a macro. CPS can be source to source transformation. So it's like a perfect fit for a scheme macro. So let's take a sum of a list, another example, very simple example. So it takes a continuation now, cont, and again, same thing. So given the, so if you say the first one without continuation, given the sum of the rest of the list, what do I need to do to complete it? So, you see that the first part of the program is not in continuation passing style and not in tail call position. Whereas, if you convert the program to into continuation passing style, you always get a function invocation in the tail call position. That is another property. It's like a side effect of converting a program into CPS style. So, CPS was not invented for getting tail call optimization. That's like a nice side effect. Yeah, so some more example, again, lower level example like Fibonacci program. Okay, so you have a generative recursion here, again, so here two invocations of fib is happening. So when you convert that into continuation passing style, those two invocations are sequentialized, or they are called in sequence. So the first one, the K1, is the continuation of the first fib. That is, given the value n, what all needs to happen to compute the fib of n? Given the value of fib n minus 1, what do I need to do to compute the value fib n? So now inside that, we are again, we have sequentialized the whole thing. Now given the value, so you still have to figure out fib of n minus 2 there, right? So given the value of fib n minus 2, so given these two values, we just have to sum and return the result. So the first one, first program was not really very sequential program, but whereas the second one has made it really sequential. Some more examples, you have say given a value, you need to find out whether it is odd. So the first one is without continuation. Second one again, so given the value x of odd, if odd of n minus 2, if that value is given, then you invoke the continuation. So again, it's the same, it's the same thing. This is a bit more bigger example. It's a higher order function, filter. So again, first part, how you do filter without continuation passing style. That is, if the given list is empty, you return empty. That is, you return an empty list. Now you look at each value of the list. If it passes the predicate test, you count that value. Else, you don't count it and keep looking at the rest of the list. Now, how do you convert this into a continuation passing style? You have multiple invocations of functions happening, right? So, if you really want to, so all the functions in your continuation passing style program should be in the CPS state, except the primitive, like plus and minus and the lowest level program. Everything else has to be CPS, otherwise there is no point. So we need to CPS the pred function as well here. So pred also takes an extra parameter k, its continuation. So again, we just return empty with the current continuation k, or else we first have to do pred. That is, you look at the first value. Now, what is the, depending on the pred result, you are going to take either of the branches. So the continuation at that point is very clear. You are going to take either of the branches given the value result of pred, right? And it's going to take one of these branches, which is also converted. So given the value pred, then what do I need to do? Filter k. I think there is a typo here. I should have called, yeah, this line should be called the pred slash k. Yeah. So everything has to be in the CPS state. Yeah, so as we said, can be done using a source to source transformation. Generally, that's what is done in every compiler, but we can also do in by hand. I have the program. I may not have time to show, but I'll post the code somewhere. So these are some resources that you can look at. SICP 4th chapter has a continuation passing style program. But the first time the name continuation passing style was invented was in the second reference, the Rabbit, the first compiler for Scheme by Guy Steele. So that had, so he invented the term continuation. It's another nice book, the third reference, which is out of print. It is one of the best reference on continuation. You can find it in Amazon Marketplace or somewhere. It's a very nice book. Programming languages, applications, and interpretations. 1 and 2, both are extremely nice references. The lambda ignore high example is from the Scheme programming language, Ken Dibwick's book. There is also a very nice Google Hangout recording by Will Bird. He has an extremely nice continuation example. Yeah, with a small parting thought, this is the end of I'll take questions. So yeah, this is a quote by Alan Perlis. I guess the previous talk here is also, I think it really echoes, and many of the other talks here. Language that does not affect the way you think is not worth knowing. So with that parting thought, I'll take more questions. TCO is part of the Scheme spec itself. Implementation is usually the CPS. Usually. No, your source program need not be in tail call position. You can write a factorial program in it. Yeah. Right. Scheme itself will convert it into tail call position. I think I understood your question. No,
is the test based on CPS comparison or?
No, CPS is an implementation detail, right? It only looks for whether it is tail call or not, right? Tail call is, CPS is one way of implementing. About it. I don't think so. Conceptually it does not, I think, because continuation of a program irrespective of evaluation order, you have rest of the program, right? You are just capturing the rest of the program in an identifier K. I don't know. I have not done any CPS in, say, Haskell. I guess Narayan might have done some. Yeah.